Hello, everybody. My name is C.B. Mamaril, and on behalf of the Systems for Action National Program Office here at the University of Kentucky, I'd like to welcome everyone to today's PHSR Research in Progress webinar, focusing on the cost, quality, and value of public health services. Today's webinar will be on the quality improvement for cost-effective sexually transmitted infection prevention services. So to give everyone an idea of the flow of the webinar today, I will first introduce our speakers who will then present their research, after which I will introduce our commentators who will then provide their commentary, and then we give our speakers a chance to respond to the commentary, and if there's any time left at the end of the webinar, we open the webinar to questions from the audience. I would also like to encourage everyone that throughout the presentation, throughout the webinar, you can also type in your questions in the chat box in the lower left-hand corner of your screen. So with that, it's my pleasure to introduce our speakers for today, starting with Dr. William Livingood, who is a senior research scientist in the Center for Health Equity and Quality Research at the University of Florida College of Medicine, Jacksonville. Bill has an extensive public health research and evaluation career spanning both public health academia and practice, and building on a successful academic career in public health and health promotion, Bill has led public health agency and healthcare institutional efforts in policy and program monitoring and evaluation. Bill has also led the recently completed comparative cost study of sexually transmitted disease services in conjunction with the Florida Public Health Practice-Based Research Network. Our other presenter is Dr. Laurie Bilello, who is a research assistant professor and associate director for the Center for Health Equity and Quality Research at the University of Florida College of Medicine, Jacksonville, where she conducts and oversees applied research on clinical care and health disparities with a focus on the public health and healthcare delivery systems. She has over 25 years of experience in healthcare administration, including community-based health initiatives, which provides her with the ability to understand complex health systems and health delivery processes. Laurie has also been an integral part to the work of the Florida Public Health Practice-Based Research Network. So with that, I turn it over to you, Bill and Laurie.
Thank you. And thanks on behalf of the Center for Health Equity and Quality Research and the Florida Public Health PBRN. And we're very pleased to present the status of our current efforts related to quality improvement and cost-effective STI services. And just to give you a little bit of background, of course, Florida, like other states in the country, have been very stressed and much more stressed because of the recession of 2008. And we're finally coming out of that, but public health has had to bear a lot of the burden of that of those stresses in reduced taxes and the funding of public health programs. STI rates are also extremely high in Florida for gonorrhea, chlamydia, and HIV. And so Florida formed its PBRN in about 2010, And since then, a couple years ago, it was originally formed out of Duval County, and since then, our Center for Health Equity and Quality Research at the University of Florida has become the coordinating center for the Florida PBRN. And we've been very successful in receiving some funding from the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation for a couple projects. Our first project with the center as the coordinating center for the PBRN was the DAX project. And that was in 2017, and we recently received our Public Health Systems and Services Research funding in 2015. So we're going to discuss a little bit today on how we built on the DAC study for this particular project, and how we are about halfway through it in a couple aspects, and I'll get back to that a little bit later. The purpose of the DAX was to identify the unit cost of delivering STI prevention and control services and to examine the effects of variation in delivering systems. Some of our key findings were the wide variability in discretionary or local tax funding for local health departments and how they impacted the services and costs. Cross-jurisdictional sharing. Florida is kind of known as more of a centralized state, but there was actually a great deal of cross-jurisdictional sharing of our DIS workers and surveillance staff for some counties, especially the rural counties tended to rely on some of the larger counties for STI services. One comment that I heard recently from the state was that some of our parts of the state are organized more like Georgia is in terms of their kind of decentralized district approach related to STI services anyway. And we had a variation in the extent of STI investigations of certain populations due to funding and staffing constraints, so people prioritized a little bit differently depending on the availability of resources. Keep in mind that some local communities are funded at about $70 per capita, and some are funded at closer to zero from the local tax dollar. So it creates a pretty huge variation in the resources that are available to local county health departments. And, of course, some counties are much wealthier than others, and so that's part of what is reflected in the per capita funding at the local level. And some services are redundant to what is provided in the private sector. So even though we have a great stress on the public sector providing services, they actually provide duplicate services to some that are provided in the private sector. And some of the screening and testing procedures were much more labor-intensive than others. And so and there wasn't any consistency across the state in regard to that. So we had quite a few findings related to the DAC study, but it didn't actually tell us what exactly we needed to do. So our QI interventions to improve cost had a couple-step process. First of all, we continue to utilize participatory research with the engagement of the practice community in our research design. And the purpose of our study was to look at the effects of program changes designed to improve cost effectiveness of delivering services. And we very much continue to partner with the Florida Department of Health, STD Subcommittee, and the Statewide Disease Control Program. So we had participation both at the county level and as the state organized its STD efforts through its strategic planning efforts that involve an STD subcommittee and a statewide disease control program council. So our study had a couple major aims. One is to identify opportunities for reducing the cost of STI services by reducing or replacing inefficient and wasteful practices. And that was based on the DAX results and then utilizing some group decision-making tools, kind of a combination of nominal and group and Delphi techniques to select the focus of our QI study. So the DAX basically told us where that we had a lot of variation, but it didn't tell us exactly where we needed to go. So we thought we had to work with the practice community to identify where those opportunities were, best opportunities were to have cost effectiveness. And so our process, the process of using these nominal group Delphi techniques in addition to some survey research techniques were to identify these universal cost-saving measures that we could use for AIM-2. And AIM-2 was to use QI evaluation and comparative effectiveness methods to determine the impact of dissemination using QI methods and impact of cost-saving measures based on the identified cost strategies that were part of AIM-1. So this two-step process, AIM-1 was to, in effect, identify where the best opportunities were, and we'll get more into detail as to what the kind of selection criteria for that were. And then second, to implement a QI process that would, in effect, focus on the best universal cost-saving measure to be disseminated across the state.
So I'm just going to go over a little bit of the process that we went through. So again, as we mentioned, we built on the DAX study, and you see the first three boxes are really based on the DAX study. We analyzed administrative data, that's including service data, costs, revenues, staffing, and the demographic information for each county. We followed that up with some interviews and key stakeholders throughout the state, especially the local CHD officials. And then we survey the county health departments to really look at why there are some variations amongst different counties. Is it due to staffing? Is it due to them using different procedures? Because as a fairly centralized state, we had statewide policies and procedures for STI services, but because of funding and staffing issues, different counties had different levels of how far they went and doing part in the vacation, what target populations they really focused on, those kind of things. So after we did several surveys, actually, we were able to have some group discussions with the county health departments and what are possible cost-saving practices that they want to explore further. And then we rated those possible strategies, and we'll talk about some of the criteria for the rating in a minute. And then finally, through another group process, we ranked which strategy we wanted to go forward for our intervention. So here's some of the possible cost-saving strategies that came up through the practice community. One was to eliminate partner notification for gonorrhea and chlamydia, either for all clients or just the non-pregnant clients. For some of them, there's priority populations, which is pregnant women and children less than 15. So there was a lot of tension between, do we do it for everybody or just the ones, just keep the ones that are our priority populations. So we looked at all clients or just for those that are in the private practice system, like private physicians. Then we also looked at whether or not we should eliminate private provider treatment verification. So what happens in this state is every positive in the state needs to be verified that the client got treated, whether it was from the county health department or from your local primary care physician. And so this is where we saw some variation because this is very time intensive. So we talked about, do we eliminate private provider treatment verification for all clients or just the non-pregnant clients? And again, the non-pregnant clients and except for the non-pregnant clients and the children. The next one that we discussed is whether or not we wanted to provide presumptive treatment for partners of gonorrhea and chlamydia without added tests. So one of the things that some health departments do this, assume that the partner is positive, treat the partner right then, and not wait for a gonorrhea chlamydia test or whatever kind of test they were doing. And the fourth idea was to text gonorrhea chlamydia results, having to call the client or have the client return to the health department to get the results. And finally, we talked about consolidating the disease intervention specialist workers across service lines. Some of the DIS workers work together between STD and HIV. Sometimes they're separate, but definitely the TB DIS workers were a separate department. Whether or not consolidating this as a one kind of staff covering multiple diseases would be a cost-saving measure. So in order to really try and rate what strategy would work best for our intervention, we had some criteria. So we looked at whether or not it would have a negative impact on the current system, whether or not it will increase the disease or some other kinds of negative impact. We asked whether or not this would save time or money or resources and whether or not it's easily implemented. Some ideas may be really great and have big impact, but be really hard to do. So based on a survey of all the health departments, we had 55 out of the 67 counties health departments reporting. We found that eliminating partner notification was something that they really didn't want to do. They thought they would have an adverse impact on the STD rates in our state if we did that. Eliminating private provider verification. This was sort of surprising because we originally thought this was the one that would be the easy thing to do, a no-brainer. About 90 to 95% of those private provider notifications, treatment verifications, were treated. So when the STD workers called the private providers, 9 out of 10 times they had treated the patient. So we were surprised that there was some resistance for this one as well. The ones that really came sort of at, you know, really low adverse impact with some savings and easy to implement were essentially providing presumptive treatment for partners with chlamydia or texting the results.
And so texting results ended up being ranked number one by the practitioners when we reviewed these results. And it's kind of, I think, in many ways, a no-brainer. It had the least resistance, and part of that was because there were no negative consequences for the STIs, no negative consequences for the health departments. There really wasn't any perceived negativity around that at all. And it even it would probably improve the quality of care given the high use of texting by clients that, by the age group of clients that tend to be most affected by STDs. They are very heavy mobile phone users, and so texting would be very compatible with them, and they'd be easily reached and so on. So it's kind of, you know, society is changing and our use of media is changing, and so this is a highly adaptive approach to a changing society. So they're very positive about the potential, not only in terms of cost savings and very minimal negative effects, but also very positive things. There were a couple, the other things, the presumptive treatment, there was concern that if we did presumptive treatment and did not do any STD testing for instance, partners, that could end up decreasing the STD rates as reported, and that would have a negative effect on the funding and all kinds of things. So they saw some downside to that. And so there was concern about that. But it's still an opportunity for cost saving. Also eliminating provider treatment verification. There was some perceived negativity around that, around, you know, taking away some of the public health concern to the providers that this is something that merits great attention, and I guess some belief that that influences some of the provider behaviors and so on. So there was some negativity. I mean, so the easy thing was the texting, and it seemed to have both positive effects related to quality and cost effectiveness and very little downside. So it kind of became a no-brainer in that regard. So what we're doing then is, so texting was selected, and we've gone through a pretty significant process to get to where we can implement this. And so our intervention is the use of QI methods to implement texting of chlamydia and gonorrhea positive and negative results and negative syphilis results of consenting clients tested at the county health departments. So we're only doing this with county health departments. All of the county health departments do STD testing, so it's relevant to the county health departments. They all provide in-house clinical testing. We propose that 30 county health departments will be implemented in the texting, and 30 counties will be a part of the comparison group. We are also doing baseline data collection primarily to assess the cost savings. Some of our reporting, we're trying to use as much reporting that's built into the system as possible, but we have to do a little bit additional data collection so that we can actually assess the cost savings. A major part of this is forming QI teams with each participating county health department because, again, we're using this is a kind of dissemination research, and we're using QI as a primary method of dissemination. Texting performance measures we're using are the client uptake, the percent of clients who opt to receive tests, the percent who called back for an appointment after receiving a positive test, and the text transmission failure rates. We'll probably also be looking at time to test too. The outcome measures we're going to be looking at are the rate of positive clients who received a text and received treatment compared to the rate of positive clients who were notified in person or by phone. So we want to see if there is a quality, if there is a difference in the quality of care that's affected. The treatment time frame, comparing the time of treatment from the initial lab date to the treatment date. for the texters and the non-texters, and the reduction in staff time and notifying patients of their results. So this kind of takes on, in addition to the dissemination research related to QI, this also has some intervention research components that there is some decent literature on texting, but it's kind of more anecdotal. It's more dealing with more case studies, and so this actually becomes a little bit more of a case control kind of study. So the QI process and reporting, we will be identifying QI teams to include key personnel in the testing consent process. PRISM is the state notification system. It's pretty much considered nationally a state-of-the-art STD data processing measuring approach, and the notification is being built into that. Fortunately, Florida has had a couple of pilot tests for the texting, so we're able to build on what's already here. The beta testing, in effect, was already done. Each of the QI teams then are asked to set targets for texting performance measures. So each team, the idea of quality improvement is kind of a ground-up kind of approach where the QI teams, the people that are responsible for the implementing the particular services, are intimately engaged and committed to achieving the results. And so they would actually have to set targets for their particular community based on the various characteristics of their community. Keeping in mind, we have very large counties, we have small counties, we have counties with very large STD rates, we have counties with much lower STD rates, so we have a lot of variation. So each county would need to basically, and some counties are dealing with college students primarily, and have very large college populations, and so a lot of variation. So each particular each county QI team would need to set its own targets. They would also need to meet regularly to review performance metrics and to discuss progress in achieving objectives, to review any kind of incidents or activities that the team observes that may be creating barriers or problems. And they would need to meet regularly to resolve problems using root cause analysis or some other kind of QI or problem-solving technique to achieve their objectives. And they would need to maintain records of their activities and to report them monthly. So we're training and working with each of the counties to, in effect, for them to help to set their targets and to help aid them in utilizing QI processes to be able to come up with optimum results. And that, again, is kind of a major purpose of our research, is this dissemination effort and using QI to disseminate it, in addition to, in effect, measuring the effects of the changes in the STD testing and reporting procedures.
So a little update where we're at now. We have definitely gotten our IRBs approved through the Florida Department of Health as well as for University of Florida. And because we are really changing the whole method of and policies and procedures of how the state approaches notification of the testing results, we had to come up with a master memorandum agreement with the Florida Department of Health that covered all the county health departments, and for us to work with them and gather data from them and help them with their QI process. So the MOU took a while, the whole getting the state central office on board and working out the policies and procedures and those kind of things took us several months, but we're done with that. We are, rolling the intervention out. We've been doing trainings to the county health departments. We've sort of done it into two waves. We have this first wave of 14 health departments that are in the training process, as well as collecting baseline data. And then we'll have a second wave in about a month once we get those folks up and running. We found that some of the larger counties that were the hub counties, for instance, Alachua County has like 14 counties. They help all these small rural counties surrounding them. That's Gainesville area, University of Florida area. they wanted to practice first on themselves and then help their surrounding counties roll this out next month. So right now, like I said, we're in the process of getting our QI teams trained, getting our baseline data, and starting next month, we will start doing the intervention. So next steps is, like I said, launching the intervention itself in April. We'll be tracking the data for 6 months, all those different process and outcome measures, as well as some of the QI measures. The nice thing about Florida is we do use this system called PRISM, which is a STI case management tracking system. So all results, positive results, and even negative results that comes from the state lab goes into PRISM. And then every time the health department employee does anything with STIs with a client, they have to input. They treated the client, they contacted the client, the client contacted them. All that information is in PRISM. So we can do lots of time to treat kind of minutes between test result received versus time to treat versus all the different notifications. So it's a great tracking tool that we'll be using to really see what the difference is. Does having the texting process speed things up, make it more willing for folks to come back and get treated? So we were going to gather 6 months worth of data and work with our 30 counties to look at the results and try to figure out what they mean and whether or not we should roll it out for the whole state. I think the goal is to roll it out throughout the whole state. And also, we've been discussing about adding HIV as part of the one of the STDs that we want to include in this process down the road as well. And I think that's it for us.
All right. Thank you, Lori. Thank you, Bill. Before we move on to our commentaries, I'd like to take the time to introduce our two commentators for today. Our first commentator will be Dr. Gulzar Shah, who is an associate professor and associate dean for research at the Jean Peng Su College of Public Health, Georgia Southern University. Gulzar has interdisciplinary training and multi-sector work experience that spans over 20 years, with appointments in both academia and public health practice agencies, both nationally and internationally. His research interests include data improvement tools, practice-based PHSSR, e-health and public health informatics, public health finance, and maternal and child health. Our other commentator is Thomas Bryant, who is Director of Informatics and Assessment at the Florida Department of Health, Volusia County. Since 2013, Thomas has worked to use data to facilitate healthy lifestyle choices for the Volusia County community and improve department programs. Thomas started his public health career in 2001, founding the Duval County Institute for Public Health Informatics and Research, and has directed evaluation programs in public health and planning agencies, and published widely in public health journals and presented in numerous public health conferences. So with that, I'd like to first turn it over to you, Gulzar.
All right. Well, good afternoon, all. I truly appreciate the opportunity to provide a commentary on this important presentation on quality improvement for reducing the cost of STI services. Needless to say, but this is really a topic which is of great interest to public health researchers. It should be a concern for public health community given the burden on public health and healthcare. So for instance, STDs are basically estimated to have $15 billion annual in direct cost nationally. STDs and STIs, so both infections and disease, are among the high priority and most common public health services delivered by local health departments. And we at Georgia PBRN also conducted a companion study to assess the variation in STI services arrangements in Georgia County health departments. And during the review of the literature and writing up the study, I realized that this is an area that really should be of concern and is of concern to both public health researchers and public health practitioners. So, through my own research, I'm convinced that in general, we need to find ways to cut cost and find efficiencies, cost efficiencies in providing those services through public health agencies. So many of you might be aware of the research that we have published on the impact of recession on health departments. So in the post-recession era, I think that finding efficiencies in STIs particularly is really important. So I appreciate the presenters appropriately providing the context and also picking up this as a topic. This research basically identified cost-saving strategies, which is an important contribution. I think that those actual strategies that were named, that's not a common public knowledge or not part of the existing research literature, none that I could find. So I think that that's really a good contribution to the existing body of knowledge. And also, as a basically, if I were to put my sociologist hat on, I think that the approach that they've used, the participatory research strategy, is going to be really suitable for this kind of research. So the participatory action research tradition has been actually used long for by researchers, and in that tradition, researchers do not particularly strive to be objective or neutral, but see the insider perspective to both empower the people being studied and trigger a desirable change or desired change. So the methodology used in this research capitalizes on the useful features of participatory research while still maintaining the objectivity to the extent possible. So their study design, which is basically a case control, is in the tradition of positivism to some extent, but still they make sure that all the benefits associated with participatory research are basically used. So this research strategy assured that the research evidence being generated was relevant and needed by the practitioners. So this approach also assures that the methods used to generate the evidence are understood by and have a buy-in of the end users, which are the practitioners. So I'm looking forward to seeing the proposed next steps completed. Bill and Lori kind of hinted at, they talked about qualitative, basically, approach and a qualitative data gathering during the QI process. I hope that they will also get to understand the populations being served, their perspective at some place. Because I understand that the case control study will give them the idea of, for example, testing failure rates, but I'm hoping that their QI, during the QI process, they will also try to gauge or assess why, for example, failures do occur. And so I'm pretty sure that's covered, but just wanted to make that point. I sincerely congratulate Bill and Laurie and their team for this important contribution and future plans to build on this useful work. With that, I would turn the time to Mr. Bryant.
Good afternoon. I'm really excited about the study, and talking with DIS workers and disease information specialists around the county, everyone has an idea of what they believe will work and the way that we need to cut costs and how we can become more effective. So with all of these ideas and anecdotal methods that are going to make a change, the approach that Bill and Lori are taking is putting a lot of structure to making quality improvement more effective in making our STI services more effective. And the practitioners are thinking that, okay, great, we'll be able to text now, and for the young people, this is how they communicate. We'll be in touch with them more often. But what it's really doing and what they're seeing is that it's going to get our positive population back into treatment more quickly, therefore reducing the spread of the disease and reducing the need for treatment and helping us to keep costs more under control in that way. The interesting part was not everyone sees it as really having an impact on the rate of getting our positives back into treatment. Because some of the programs are saying, well, we're already operating at 98% in getting our folks in for treatment, but it's the amount of time it takes to get them into treatment that they think was most important. But it also has another effect on the public health practice, and that is that of modeling. In going through this process, you're modeling for the local health department how we can then begin to address our problems and issues. It's very difficult to get a culture of QI within local health departments when we're experiencing tremendous cuts, therefore our workloads are increasing. So how can we then take on another process on top of everything that we're having to do when we frequently have doubled our workload because of cuts in our services and cuts in our resources? So now health departments are seeing that, yes, we can set up methods by which we can test and evaluate and assess our treatment techniques so that we can become far more efficient. And then it's also telling the local health departments and the local workers that your input is important and it's being taken into consideration. Frequently, we will have ideas about how we should approach treatment or how we should approach issues and various problems, and we share our ideas, and then it's done the way the edict comes down from above how things should be handled. And the fact that we can now then turn and show them that this is what, these are the responses of the health department. These are the methods they thought would be more effective, and these methods are actually being implemented and assessed. So all of that is the modeling, the inclusion of the local community, all of those are very positive effects on how public health practice can be involved in quality improvement and be involved in making a difference of the methodologies that we use. And it's taking on kind of an era of we oftentimes talk about empowering our clients. This is empowering our local communities and our local workers to take responsibility of assessing their methodology and knowing that they can have a positive impact and they have the skill sets to begin to determine what's effective and what's not effective. And I believe that's it for me. And I'm just really excited about the project, and we're looking forward to seeing what the results produce.
Thank you. Thank you, Thomas. Thank you, Gulzar, for those excellent points and your commentaries, for sharing them. Before I turn it back to Bill and Laura, Gulzar, would you like to add something more?
No, I said you are very welcome. But last-minute thought that I had in my head but couldn't say because I thought maybe I was using too much time.
No,
you
had a lot of
time. Was that I thought that the recommendations were really bold, but their approach assured that the source of evidence is authentic. I also noted that their specific case control method and measures that were proposed, they were very clearly defined. So the other studies, other people who want to follow the study protocol, they can easily operationalize those measures. I wanted to, you know, express this afterthought, which I think that kind of represent my part of my assessment of this presentation. So thank you for the chance to do that.
Good point, Gulzar. Thank you again. Thank you, Gulzar. Thank you, Thomas. And before I turn it back over to Lori and Bill to be able to respond to the commentaries, I'd like to remind everyone that if you have questions, please do type them out in the chat box. There's generally a lag before we can get those questions. But if we don't get to your questions before the end of the webinar, we'll make sure to forward them to Lori and Bill so that they can also answer them even after the webinar is over. So with that, I'd like to turn it back over first to you, Lori and Bill, to respond to the comments before we open the webinar, the questions to the rest of the audience. So go ahead.
Well, let me start with wow. comments from both an academic research perspective and from the practice perspective were extremely complimentary and very insightful, I think, about the value of this particular approach to research and the potential for its findings. So I want to thank both Gulzar and Thomas for their expert commentary. It was excellent.
And I think this really shows where having a participatory approach really does come, not only give us some great tools and even research questions to pursue, versus just, you know, for us trying to come up with this stuff on our own.
Yeah, and let me just add that, you know, I think sometimes people add community engagement and they have an advisory committee or they do something and it's fairly perfunctory and they go through some routines and all. And I think with what we've been doing, we've demonstrated that the input from the practice community has been not only exceptionally insightful, but vital for us to progress in achieving the objectives of our research, and that input from the practice community really is making this some outstanding research that will be of value both to the research and the practice community.
And I'm hoping that this will work. And I have to tell everybody, this is...
I think someone forgot to mute their line. You can hear you in the background. But anyway, thank you so much, Bill and Lori. I think now we can open the webinar to questions from the audience. Do we have one from, I guess, Lynn has raised her hand. Anne, Kara, I don't know how it works technically, if we're able to give them audio, or do they just keep chat typing in their questions in the chat box?
And all of the doctors have sort of written me off. They said that
Should I type or talk?
Yeah, go ahead. We can hear you. Is this Lynn? We can hear you. Yeah, so go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say this is great. It's, you know, we have the directed project in California and Alabama that's researching STI practices in local health departments, and we have been finding tremendous variation in the ability of local health departments to implement the different practices, particularly the extended partner notification, but also in screening and other areas. So I found this approach fascinating, of really trying to work together to identify the most cost-effective practices and implement them. And I just sent your presentation around California, so thank
Perfect.
You.
Perfect.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lynn. Are there any more questions? I think while we're waiting for questions, if there are any, I'm just curious, since you talked about the QI aspect, building on the DACS project results, and then, you know, having a more participatory approach in identifying those cost-saving practices. You mentioned these different possible cost-saving strategies, and then you find out later that texting was one of the things that ranked highest. Is that how it came about? I mean, it came about through the participatory part where you were looking for strategies that they mentioned texting, Lori, Bill? And I guess a follow-up question to that would be, are there models really around the country that are implementing this texting protocol in notifying the clients?
There are a few places. I think the Peoria was one of the first places, and we've had a few counties in in Florida. Some of them have actually appeared in some literature. You know, I think on a CDC website and in some other journals, basically a brief report kind of thing. So it is starting to show up, and that's why we say it's somewhat a little bit anecdotal, almost case study based right now. But there does seem to be a lot of potential for it. But what we found, and there were a few counties in Florida that were doing it, but our rating process that Lori went over found that, in effect, we actually had all of the counties rating these different potential proposals for potential adverse effects. And the texting had the very, very lowest potential of having any adverse effect. And probably when you get down to 14%, you're getting down to almost noise levels of perceived adverse effects. And but there were a couple other areas. I mean, the reducing the or providing presumptive treatment actually was considered to be very cost-effective and easy to implement, but there were those potential negative consequences. So I think there are a couple areas here that, including the eliminating the verification with private sector providers, I think these things are all worth investigating and doing additional study. And I think doing it methodically with the practice community is a very important component of this. So, but yeah, texting ended up, we use these three variables to decide, but then we also left it to the practice community to actually make the decision, and they're the ones that made the decision that texting was the best approach.
Excellent. So I would imagine that there would be a plan maybe later on to cost out these processes too as well.
Yeah, we're trying to capture the cost. We are doing that with some baseline data collection, and we'll be using the other data then data that's collected regularly. We have a very robust data collection around STD services, so through the PRISM. So we will be able to estimate some, we'll have some very strong data, I think, to estimate some cost benefits.
That would be excellent, exciting to look forward to.
And there have been some cost benefits reported, by the way, already. So,
okay, I think that was really an interesting part of your presentation today. So I don't see any more questions. Anne, Kara, is there anything that appeared in your chat box? I guess.
No, I think Lynn Silver has her hand raised again.
Okay, Lynn, do you still have another question, Lynn?
Yeah.
We're all. Go ahead.
No, I didn't. I'm sorry. That was an accident.
No problem. We're still also trying to figure out how to make it efficient using the ReadyTalk web conference seminar software. So, but anyway, I think it was you, Anne, that asked Lori to sort of mention their presentation of the ARM this June. If you want to make a plug, Lori, Bill, sort of last words for this webinar.
We just got notification yesterday that our project has been accepted both in the regular ARM meeting, the Academy Health Research meeting, as well as the PHSR meeting. So we'll be at both meetings presenting this work.
All right. Lori, so anyone who's going, yeah, go ahead.
This is Anne. I was just wondering what you'll be able to present in June. Will you have any of the results?
We're assuming we'll have some of the baseline data of what it takes. We're doing some time studies right now, how much minutes it takes to do the traditional way to notify people about the test results. And we should have at least a couple months worth of the texting version, too. So hopefully we can show some of those results for the June meeting.
Yeah, part of the QI is to have is to have regular reporting and have each of the county health departments reviewing their progress in achieving their objectives on a weekly, monthly, if not weekly basis. And so they'll be reporting that. So we'll be able to have some trending data related to implementation and have a good idea, I think, at that point in time of how well the project is going. And we'll be able to present some of that data at at the Academy.
All right. Excellent. It's exciting to look forward to. So again, with that, I'd like to thank Bill and Lori for sharing us your research today and for presenting the webinar. We'd like to thank again Gulzar and Thomas for your commentaries. And we'd like to thank everyone for coming to join us this afternoon. And we just want to remind everyone that if you've missed some of the past webinars, that those are available for download from our website. And we'd also like to invite you for the upcoming webinars. So if you could take a look, we have one that's coming up in April 6th. So we also hope to see you there. So with that, I'd like to thank everyone for joining us today. And have a great day. Thank you so much. And hope to see you soon.